SpaceX launched its 13th mission of the year on Monday, December 16th, as a twice-flown Falcon 9 booster took to the skies for the third time, carrying a satellite for Singapore-based startup and Japanese broadband provider. The SpaceX Falcon 9 rocket lit up the skies over Florida's Space Coast as it carried its payload, a heavyweight communication satellite, into space from Space Launch Complex 40 here at Cape Canaveral Air Force Station. The powerful telecom craft lifted off from Florida at 7:10 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, Monday, after a smooth countdown. The Hefty communication satellite, built by Boeing, is on the way to a lofty perch more than 22,000 miles, nearly 36,000 kilometers, over the Pacific Ocean, where the satellite will be especially beneficial to residents in remote provinces and villages across the South Pacific, especially healthcare institutions and schools. Many of the schools and hospitals throughout the region are remote and therefore could rely on the coverage this satellite will provide to ensure patients receive proper care and children have access to better education with more access to online resources. In this video, Engineering Today will discuss this startup launching broadband satellite on SpaceX Falcon 9 rocket into orbit to connect Pacific Islands. Let's get into details. The SpaceX Falcon 9 rocket, propelled by a first-stage booster flown twice before, streaked through cloud layers over Cape Canaveral as it turned eastward over the Atlantic Ocean and exceeded the speed of sound in the first minute of the flight. The launch occurred just 3 days after SpaceX test-fired its veteran Falcon 9 booster. The star of this launch, a sooty and scorched SpaceX Falcon 9, previously lifted the CRS-17 and CRS-18 cargo resupply missions to the International Space Station earlier this year, May and July. Monday's flight marked the 13th of the year for the California-based aerospace company, following a shiny new booster that delivered a fresh batch of supplies to the space station just 11 days earlier. Following a standard launch protocol, the first stage shut down and separated 2.5 minutes into the mission and descended back through the atmosphere. Approximately 8 minutes after launch, the rocket's first stage touched down on one of the company's two drone ships, Of Course I Still Love You, which was stationed in the Atlantic Ocean. Once back at the Florida launch base, the booster, designed for up to 10 flights, could launch again. SpaceX has been recovering Falcon 9 and, more recently, Super Heavy boosters since 2015 and has done 47 successful first-stage recoveries in total. But its fairing-catching system is a much more recent introduction. SpaceX first controlled the descent of and recovered a fairing half in 2017, but did so by dropping it into the ocean. It later began attempting to recover it using a barge recovery ship to keep from having to fish it out of the sea, and managed to do that successfully for the first time with one half of the two-part fairing used in a SpaceX Falcon Heavy launch this past June. This attempt to catch the fairings was not successful. SpaceX said on Twitter that both halves missed the waiting boats narrowly, but added that recovery teams will still seek to pull them from the ocean and see about reusing them on future missions. SpaceX reflew a recovered fairing in November for the first time, and Musk has said previously that reuse of this part could save SpaceX as much as $6 million per mission, which is about 10% of the total cost of the launch. The second stage, meanwhile, ignited its vacuum-related engine for two firings to inject the mission's satellite payload, named JCSAT-18 Kacific 1, into an elliptical transfer orbit stretching more than 12,600 miles or 20,300 kilometers above Earth, on the way to a final operating position in geostationary orbit over the equator. The SpaceX Falcon 9 released its satellite passenger 33 minutes after liftoff, and a live camera view from the second stage of the rocket showed the JCSAT-18 Kacific 1 spacecraft flying away from the launch vehicle, backdropped by the curvature of the Earth. Boeing officials confirmed the satellite radioed its status to ground teams after arriving in orbit Monday night. JCSat 18 Kacific 1 is a 6,800-kilogram condominium satellite, or CondoSat, from Boeing. Equipped with distinct payloads for Kacific and SkyPerfect JSAT corporations, an established satellite operator based in Tokyo. For SkyPerfect JSAT, the JCSat 18 payload will provide KU and KA band capacity over large parts of the Asia-Pacific, including Russia's Far East. It's the 18th geostationary satellite in the operator's fleet, and second with high throughput capacity, enabling higher speed broadband services than traditional satellites. Kacific 1 is an all KA band payload with high throughput coverage designed for island nations that lack dedicated satellite coverage. Kacific, headquartered in Singapore, was founded in 2013 by Christian Petero, then a 20-year satellite industry veteran with experience in satellite engineering and business strategy development. Our vision is very much to bridge the digital divide, to drive economic development, Petero said in a pre-launch media briefing on Monday. It will really be a game changer deep inside society, Petero said of Kacific One, and it will provide a public service that will also connect all kinds of government services, not only schools and hospitals, but you can also think of connecting post offices, delivering ID cards and passports, locally inside villages, as well as police stations and fire stations. The continuous coverage would dramatically improve the quality of life of those who call the region home, and it would be an added perk for tourists. In one village alone, using the coverage currently available, medical staff have been able to connect with doctors in bigger cities and save lives, according to Petero. Most people across the South Pacific have access to iPads and smartphones, but are just waiting for the technology, meaning internet service, to arrive to better their lives, Petero said. Kacific has leased capacity on third-party satellites to begin realizing its vision of beaming broadband connectivity to millions of underserved people across the Asia-Pacific region. Now, after some financial maneuvering, loans, and equity fundraising, Kacific has its own satellite infrastructure in orbit. It's been 6.5 years of hard work to get here. The most difficult part was really to get financing in a project like this. According to Petero, Kacific invested more than $200 million in developing its part of the JCSat 18 Kacific 1 mission, including Kacific's share of the launch costs, satellite production costs, and ground systems. It was a lot of grit, a bit of luck here and there, he said. After he founded Kacific, Petero initially raised funding from friends and family, then began making connections with prospective users of the company's satellite broadband service. Kacific then issued a tender to build its first satellite and selected Boeing for the job in partnership with SkyPerfect JSAT. Kacific One is Kacific's first satellite and almost didn't happen because of difficulty attracting capital. Kacific ran into headwinds securing the funding to pay Boeing for the new spacecraft due to a lapse in financing ability of the Export-Import Bank of the United States. In the end, Petero said the company secured loans to pay Boeing for the satellite. Earlier this month, Kacific announced it secured $160 million in new financing led by the Asian Development Bank, ADB, and Garant Co., an infrastructure investment organization. The support of Garant Co., ADB, and private investors will be pivotal in providing the long-term certainty that will allow Kacific to transition seamlessly into operational mode. It was really, really white-knuckle until the end, but we managed to close that, Petero said Monday. We were really incentivized to close this before launching. Now that the spacecraft is in orbit, the engine burns will also move the satellite's orbit over the equator, where its orbital velocity will match the rate of the Earth's rotation. About half an hour after liftoff, the SpaceX Falcon 9 rocket deposited the satellite into an elliptical transfer orbit, where its onboard engine will maneuver the satellite into a final geostationary orbit more than 22,000 miles, 35,000 kilometers above the equator. This orbit will allow the satellite to give constant coverage to the Asia-Pacific area. Boeing engineers will oversee a series of maneuvers using JCSat 18 Kacific 1's onboard main engine to circularize its orbit. The engine burns will move the satellite's orbit over the equator, where its orbital velocity will match the rate of Earth's rotation. During its planned 15-year mission, JCSAT-18 Kacific 1 will be parked at 150 degrees east longitude, giving the satellite an expansive coverage zone stretching across the Asia-Pacific. Panero said region covered by Kacific's Ka-band payload is home to some 600 million people. Connecting communities gives them access to emergency healthcare, gives them access to evacuation, said Panero. They're living in very precarious areas of the world. The broadband access will provide critical communication channels to the region, which is often ravaged by natural disasters, such as earthquakes, landslides, tsunamis, and volcanic eruptions. The biggest obstacle to extend broadband across the Asia-Pacific is one of topography. Broadband is delivered primarily by copper or fiber-optic cables, including some that stretch under the Atlantic Ocean. They're expensive to install, so internet service providers mostly target urban areas, where they can get the most bang for their buck, while rural communities are often left out. In the Asia-Pacific region, where more than 80% of the population lives in rural areas, the lack of connectivity is glaring. This is what Kacific is designed for specifically, Petero said. It's a high-throughput satellite, is equipped with 56 high-power beams that will provide mobile and broadband services from space. It's transmitting over high-power Ka band, hence the name Kacific, Ka band for the Pacific. And it has gateways to connect satellite to high-speed backbone internet in Australia, in the Philippines, and in Indonesia. The satellite will provide Ka-band internet coverage to 25 countries across the South Pacific. Kacific says its Ka-band payload will cover a swath from Nepal in the west to French Polynesia in the east, and from the Philippines in the north to New Zealand in the south. Users with good ground antennas will be able to achieve download speeds of up to 50 to 100 megabits per second through Kacific's network. A few ground stations called teleports will bounce Kacific One signals to antennas, creating internet hotspots. At about $500 to $1,000 each, Patero said the antennas may be too expensive for most people to install at their homes, but they're a perfect kit for schools, hospitals, and community centers. Patero said that Kacific One aims to stream high-speed, reliable, low-cost broadband to rural and suburban areas. The focus is to get the satellite service up and running, and if all goes well and shareholders agree, there could eventually be a Kacific 2. It would almost be silly not to try to replicate that and do it in faster time with a better cost of capital, he said. Panero said a Kacific 2 satellite would augment Kacific 1 capacity and expanding westward across Asia, but possibly Africa. But he did not give a timeline for Kacific 2. Thanks for watching. Please subscribe for more videos like this. Hit the like button if you find the video interesting. And kindly provide your valuable feedback in the comment section. This will help us to improve.